Good morning, church. We just want to welcome you wherever you are online. Welcome you to our first post-Christmas service. We are very excited to get to worship our Lord this morning, but we still want to bring just a little bit more Christmas cheer. So if you guys want to go ahead and come to the Lord and worship with us this morning, let's pray. Lord, we just thank you. We love you. We thank you. You are the reason for this season, God, and we are so grateful to just get to worship in your name this morning and give you all the glory that you deserve, God.
Came to see the baby, stood by his mother's side. Here lay the Savior inside a manger. Oh, what a glorious night! Oh, what a glorious night! I hear the angels singing, hallelujah.
God so loved the world that he gave us his one. Whoever believes in him will live forever. So bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. He sees open arms, for God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated, now it is well. I'm a walking in freedom, for God so loved, from God so loved the world. Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, for the wonders of his love. His one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated, now it is well. I'm walking in freedom, from God so loved, from God so loved the world. So bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world. Amen.
The Lord bless. His favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May His favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around and within you. He is with you, He is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 He is for you. Oh, amen, 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 amen,
Lord. Yes, God, we can't even contemplate the blessings that you have for us, God. You know, we get light of one or two, but God, we're not perfect and we miss so many things that you want to give us. Lord, we are not in a place and ready to receive all the blessings that you want to bestow upon us, God. And I just pray in this time and in this season that we find our way to just be open to everything that you want to say to us in our time of prayer, in our time of worship, in our time of just rest, God, that we just be open and perceptive to the words that you have for us, God, for what you want for our lives. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Morning, church. You know, as I was preparing for this communion time this week, and wherever you're at, if you are a believer in Christ, I just encourage you to have your elements and to take communion with us this morning. I was thinking a lot this week about your own kind of mortality, and in that, because I did what a very adult thing you can say this week, and that's look at life insurance, and that's a whole lot of fun. I'm sure that you guys all agree that there's nothing quite as wonderful as looking at that. And but in that, in talking about plans for the future and taking care of kids should anything happen, and all of that sort of thing, one of the songs we sang earlier is part of the reason why it's on our list, because that's the first thing that popped into my head as we were doing this thing that just seems like it's, you know, for me, not a pleasant thing to think about, but it encouraged me to think about the words in the song that we sang earlier. And those words were, may His favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children and their children. And how wonderful it is to just be in the favor of our Lord and the wonderful things that you have and that you want for our lives. The blessing that it was of you going to the cross, the cross that's the symbol that we have, just helps us remember the sacrifice that you made for each and every one of us here on earth. And not only are we responsible for what we do now as far as following you, but we have a whole generation after generation in a way that we're kind of responsible for too. As I raise my little boys, I want them to make sure that they make good decisions and are followers of you. And the responsibility that brings and the wonderfulness and the great things that come with that too. And just the peace knowing that they love you, God. And so as we come to our time to remember what our Lord did on that night when Jesus was with his disciples, Jesus took the bread, breaking it, giving it to each one, saying, "This is my body given for you. Eat in remembrance of me." And in that same way, Jesus took the cup, giving it to each one, saying, "This is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant. Drink for the forgiveness of sins." Lord, in this time, we just remember the sacrifice you made, what you did for all of us, God. God, a greater gift has never been given, Lord, and it's a gift that we should never, ever take for granted. Lord, and I pray that as we come to at the end of another year with so many things to come, so many unknown things, God, that we just pray, Lord, for your blessings, Lord, and we just know that that we need to make sure that we keep our eyes open for what you want to bless us with, God, and not let those things go by. And it's your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to have you with us today, and I hope as we prepare to face a new year that it is much better than last year. I want to start today by reading from Mark's Gospel, chapter 2. The title for the message is Challenge for 2021. In Mark's Gospel, it says this, "And when Jesus returned to Capernaum for some days, it was reported that he was at home, and many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them, and they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.' Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. For who can forgive sins but God alone?' And immediately Jesus perceived in his spirit that they were thus questioning within themselves, and he said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, "Your sins are forgiven," or to say, "Rise, take up your bed and walk"? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home.' And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, 'We never saw anything like this. I thought that this message was going to be a very short sermon, for I decided that kind of the greatest challenge for 2021 would simply be get through 2020. I did struggle a little to decide what to preach on as we enter a new year. And then as I was reading in 2 Peter, I noticed a couple of verses that I had underlined. It was this: therefore, I intend always to remind you of these things. Though you know them and are established in the truth that you have, I think it right, as long as I am in this body, to stir you up by way of reminder. Leading up to 2020, last year, the leadership team came up with a statement of purpose for our church, a statement based upon biblical principles that clarifies in simple terms why we exist as a church. And so here is the test question for 2021. How many remember what it was? That is terrible. Here it is. This was our statement of purpose: to know Jesus and to make him known. Although reversed in order, it is a condensed version of what we call the Great Commission. It's the last message that Jesus left ringing in the ears of his disciples in Matthew 28. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority, both in heaven and on earth, has been given unto me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the close of the age." Today, I want to focus on the first half of the Great Commission. Jesus' command to go and make disciples of all nations. We call that evangelism. And one of the things that Mark 2 points out is what happens when, or why evangelism doesn't happen in our world today. For it points out that evangelism fails to happen when we do not understand the need of people. There are literally thousands of people in and around Coquille who, to the words of a little chorus we used to occasionally sing, people need the Lord. We do not understand the need. It is tough enough to live a life as a Christian. After all, Jesus said, "In the world, you will have tribulation." But it is a hopeless case without Christ. Evangelism fails to happen when we do not understand Jesus, or first of all, evangelism doesn't happen when we do not understand the need. And secondly, evangelism fails to happen when we do not understand Jesus' ability to heal and forgive and change people's lives. In Mark 2, if the four friends were not aware of the uniqueness of Jesus, they would not have brought their friend to meet him. I mean, there were a group of people in the audience and where Jesus was speaking who were observing Jesus, and in their sarcasm, because of the events that happened, they said, they really stated a great truth. They said, "Who can forgive sin but God alone?" And that's one thing that Christians, true Christians, really do believe, that Jesus is God. Just last week, if you remember, we spoke of the mystery of the gospel, how the Christ was wrapped in mystery is God's gift. For in John 1:1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. And we have beheld his glory, glory as of the only Son of the Father." Or in Colossians chapter 1, he is the image, Paul says, of the invisible God. For in him the fullness of God is pleased to dwell. Or Hebrews chapter 1, where the writer says that he, Jesus, reflects the glory of God and bears the very stamp of his nature, upholding the universe with his word of power. Either you accept Jesus as Lord and God, or you declare him a lunatic. That is our only choice. Who alone but God can forgive sin? But evangelism also fails when we do not understand our responsibility. In other words, we have seen the need, we realize Jesus' ability to heal, forgive, and change people's lives. And if we do not recognize or understand our responsibility as followers of Jesus, then evangelism fails. When we fail to bring people to meet Jesus. I mean, this idea of personal responsibility is not something that people want to talk about these days. It was interesting to me. In fact, the military kind of gets the idea here. Just this past week, maybe you heard it on the news, but there was the general who's in charge of the distribution of vaccines for the nation. There was a mix-up and a slight hang-up in the delivery system. And he came on television and he says, "I'm the one that is responsible. It was my mistake. I'm the one that was in charge. Blame me." That is a very unusual statement. Reminds me of another general. If you remember General Eisenhower on D-Day, when he sent the troops knowing that many would be killed in battle on D-Day, he had two letters ready in case D-Day was a failure. And in that letter, he made plain that the decision was his alone to go forward with D-Day. But thank God he never had to deliver that message, because D-Day was a success. And when we fail to recognize our responsibility, evangelism fails to happen. In other words, when these friends of the paralytic took him to see Jesus, they had to overcome a number of obstacles and inconveniences. Maybe somebody had to skip a day going fishing, or perhaps they had to cancel a tea time on the golf course. And then they faced the crowd at the door. I mean, if you had packed your friend down to see Jesus and couldn't get in the door, what would you do? These guys were not going to give up. I mean, they went up the outside steps onto the roof and tore up the roof and made a hole and lowered their friend down in front of Jesus. I mean, somebody probably had to go somewhere and find some rope. There was a lot of things that they had to overcome. They had to get their friend into the presence of Jesus. We need to recognize our responsibility to tell others about Jesus. In God's word, he makes it very clear that those who have experienced God's grace are to tell others. Just last week, we talked about the shepherds on the hills around Bethlehem, and how at the kind of the end of the shepherd story is, as they left the manger, it says they went about telling everyone what they had heard concerning this child. And this is the focal point of the message this morning. Our responsibility as citizens of the kingdom of God. And my prayer is that for this next year especially, that we will start asking the question, how can I share God's grace and love effectively with people that I meet day to day? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul says that the love of Christ compels us. It is interesting that when I stood at ground zero after 9/11 and watched firefighters and other workers dig through the rubble, they worked day and night to save just one person. And when people came into the assistance center where I was working, no one said, I'm trying to find the I'm digging for the $240 million worth of gold that is buried somewhere in the rubble. That is not what they were searching for. No, they were searching for a person, a son, a daughter, a mother, a father. Someone once said, if a man has a soul, and he does, and if that soul can be won or lost for eternity, and it can, then the most important task you and I have is to reach the lost. What will it take in 2021 for you and I to become more concerned about things that are eternal than for the things we see in front of us every day? I want to list for you five reasons that we cannot be silent. The first reason is that Jesus Christ gave his followers a clear command. In Mark 16, we've talked about Matthew 28, but in Mark 16, 15, he says, you are to go out into all the world and preach the good news to everyone, everywhere. The command of Jesus Christ is that the duty of every man, woman, and child who confesses him as Lord and God is to be witnesses for him. In Acts 1, 6, he says, you shall be my witness. And a witness who refuses to speak the truth is held in contempt. I don't know about you, but I am a little fearful of being held in contempt by the God of the universe. Second, Scripture tells us that men and women are lost without Christ. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. That is a very exclusive claim that many people don't like. But without Christ, people are lost for eternity. The third reason is, rather than being not interested, I think of the thousands of people that are in and around Coquille, in the whole county, there are people who are hungry to hear the gospel. And if we do not speak out, they will turn to some other religion, Scientology or some form of religion, and try to satisfy that which is missing in their life. You and I, as Christians, have the truth. That makes some people upset. If what Jesus said is truth, then all other religions are false. And some people don't want to hear that. Because Christianity, by its very nature, is exclusive. But fourth, as Christians, we have in our possession the greatest gift available, the greatest news ever announced, that Jesus Christ is born. Not only was he born, but he lived in history. That he was crucified, and on the third day rose again. And because of that truth, because of that miraculous event, we have fellowship and peace with God and the gift of eternal life. That is what we have. Jesus has paid our debt. Fifth, Paul writes that the love of Jesus Christ for us and our love for him compels us to share him with others. Jesus said, again, I ask that I have many times over the last 5.5 years, do we care what Jesus says? Jesus said, the one who obeys me is the one who loves me. If you take a close look at John 14, verse 21, it says that Jesus measures our love for him by the extent and genuineness of our obedience to him. And as we obey, he promises that he will reveal himself more and more to us. What are we to obey when it comes to witnessing of Jesus? We have a specific command to go and make disciples, that we are to go into all the world and preach the good news to everyone, everywhere. There is nothing that is more important for a Christian to do. The most important thing you and I can do this year is to share the love of Christ with those who do not know him, those who do not follow him. And for some of us, that may be someone just across the dinner table. It may be a person just across the street. It may be a person in our community that you know. We are to be in prayer, to be asking that God would open the door, to give us the opportunity and be attentive to the leading of the Holy Spirit in doing just that. That is the challenge for 2021, and for every Christian that hears my voice this day. Shall we pray? Our God and Father, Lord, you have promised your Holy Spirit, and every time in Scripture that your Holy Spirit is given, it is for boldness to testify of Jesus. And so, Father, we would pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, we may be witnesses of the one who loved us so much that he left heaven to come to earth to show us how to live and how to find our way back home. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, we thank you for being with us this day, and we just pray that you have a blessed new year, that you get through everything that we have to get through to make it a blessed year this coming year. If you want to support our ministry here at Coquille Christian Community Church, we invite you to give online or mail a check to the church or just drop it by the office. But you have a happy and blessed new year.